Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Cloud Security Coffee Break. I'm John Tonello, your Cloud Security Advocate, and I'm joined today by Robert Morey, who has been on the show before. Great to see you, Robert.
Good morning.
And he is not in the cold mountains of somewhere. He's in the the warmer, humid recesses of
Hotlanta.
Hotlanta. Yeah. Wow.
Which nobody calls it that. Please don't.
Today's topic, we're going to be really picking up on the masterclass that some of our colleagues put on a couple weeks ago, which is really a soup to nuts, start from here kind of presentation about the challenges of the cloud in general and moving into cloud security. And we'll talk a little bit about that as well. And I'll provide some links. If you did happen to miss that, you can tune into it. It's very good. And we have another one coming up a little later this year. Before we get into that, I also want to encourage everybody that if you have questions during the session, please don't hesitate to use the Q&A or if you just have a thought. Please put it in the chat and we'll go from there. So Robert, I just thought we'd take a moment to have you introduce yourself. And you know, as always, I always have big brains on the coffee break and wanted to share your expertise.
Absolutely, appreciate it. So yeah, my name is Robert Morey. I'm one of the cloud security engineers over here on the Tenable Cloud Security team. I'm actually come to Tenable by way of acquisition, as Tenable was acquiring a lot of these kind of cloud native capabilities through Accurix. I came on board, so I've been on the team sort of a combined 2.5 years now. Most of my background is around DevOps, so I'll be getting very excited as I get to some of the shift left and sort of more DevOps-y pieces of our conversation today, but interested to see, how we can help you out and talk about cloud security.
Excellent. Yeah, and we share that common background. You know, I worked for Puppet and Chef in the automation world, and DevOps is near and dear to me. And cloud security, as we both know, is a lot about DevOps and I would say non-legacy ways of doing things. That's a polite way for me to say that. I'm just going to share my screen here because I have a couple of slides. So I want to really focus most of our time on what the demos are, but the agenda, we're going to talk about the cloud, the public cloud stack, and what it's like to do your work there, which is a little different from on-prem, just a little. We're going to onboard multiple cloud accounts, show you how to do that within Tenable Cloud Security. And then that's one of the core foundations of Tenable Cloud Security, actually. It's not managing just one public cloud, but multiple ones. We're going to look at scanning the code you use to provision those cloud systems. We're going to look at scanning for vulnerabilities, generally what we like to call vulnerability management, and that's instances and container images, which has newly been added to Tenable Cloud Security. We'll talk about applying security policies. There are well over 1,500 that are built in, but there's also no code, low code editor for you to create your own custom policies. And we'll look at some steps to use these things, all these tools together to really do the work of security in the cloud. The July masterclass I mentioned was building a resilient cloud security program. And I stuck in this QR code because you can't click on things in Zoom, at least not in a way I've discovered. So if you scan this QR code, it'll take you to that session, which is on demand and available at any time. And that features Alex Fegensen and Paul Anderson, Heather Payton, who really put together a nice comprehensive grounding in the kinds of topics. So if you haven't had a chance to see that, please go back and take a look. Of course, I always like to plug previous coffee breaks. Our last one was on the new container security built into cloud, Tenable Cloud Security. Great new capabilities there that we'll actually touch on a little bit today with Robert. And I just wanted, you know, this is at the sort of highest level. What's the difference? Why cloud security is different? And the shared responsibility model is at the core, and we've had programs on that in the past as well. You know, what's your responsibility and what's the cloud vendor's responsibility? And multiple clouds means multiple complexity. And as Alex Feginson has said on the coffee break in the past, it's not just additive, it's sort of exponential. The expertise that you need to manage resources in multiple clouds ain't easy. And that's one of the core principles behind Tenable Cloud Security. Code and APIs, not hands-on. In the modern cloud native world, you're not shelling into systems to make tweaks. You're probably not using dashboards, but you're using APIs and you're using code like Terraform and Kubernetes, YAML, and container image building and that sort of thing. A lot different. And of course, there's a lot more. And we'll talk about that. And by more, I mean you have a lot more containers than you ever had instances. And preventive versus reactive. Because we're going into DevOps, as Robert was saying, you know, we love this side of the house, and which is commonly known as shifting left, but you're really able to look at your code, do some testing and doing security much earlier in the process before things become running systems. And we talk about it, you know, the horse isn't out of the barn, isn't even out of the paddock when we go ahead and are able to scan and do some stuff. So with that, I'm going to show this the stack slide and let Robert pick it up from here. Robert.
Yeah, appreciate that. And so I, you know, as I'm talking with a lot of our customers, I always, in fact, this is generally the one slide that I show, and I kind of circle back to it a few times. But it really sort of gives us a template about how we can think about these cloud and container native workloads. What is the overall exposure risk of those workloads? What are the different layers that we need to address? And how can we start introducing additional security assurance as we're looking at these sort of workloads? And sort of the tip of this spear is application security. Tenable absolutely has some capabilities in this space, namely our web application security scanner. However, I am not that subject matter expert and probably not going to be a core piece of the discussion today, but it is an important piece of the puzzle. So I'll be, you know, sprinkling in a few pieces of that. But as we go down through the rest of the stack, this is absolutely part of what Tenable considers our cloud security suite. So as we go down from the top, we have kind of container and cloud native vulnerability management. Obviously, Tenable has been doing vulnerability management now for decades. However, as we get into, to a certain extent, the cloud, and definitely as we get into containers, those models can shift quite dramatically. And so we need to sort of revisit how we're building these vulnerability management practices and apply them in a much more cloud and container native way. And so I'll definitely be touching on that throughout the presentation. As we go down further, we get to the classic cloud security posture management / Kubernetes security posture management. That's typically at least the first or primary use case that we come across as we're talking to customers about cloud security. It's probably the first thing that comes to mind. It's definitely the most popular use case and the use case where we see most movement in the industry. And so obviously we'll be touching on that, and I'll actually be starting with that as we get through to the demo portion. And then finally, and sort of where Tenable has some fairly unique capabilities is looking at not just the running artifacts themselves, but also how we got there. What are the workflows? How are our engineering teams actually configuring, building, and deploying these workloads? So as John has already mentioned, we're looking at sort of the cloud native pieces with Terraform and CloudFormation and ARM templates. But then as we get into Kubernetes, where these sort of workflows are no longer optional, there is really no dashboard to deploy workloads out to Kubernetes. At some level, you are addressing it through YAML manifest or Helm charts or customized files. And we want to be able to basically utilize those workflows to get a much broader, much deeper look into really the entire lifecycle of these sort of workloads and give you a much clearer picture, much more complete picture of your overall security posture. So those are the major pieces I'll be addressing as I go through the demo a little bit later, but hopefully that kind of gives you a good idea of kind of how Tenable is looking at cloud security and how we can help you on those different layers.
That was a great setup, Robert. A lot of pieces here, and the next piece we're gonna dive right into the demos. And if I can, what is Tenable Cloud Security? You know, at the highest level, it's a module within Tenable One platform, which Tenable came out with Cache last fall, which encapsulates a lot of different tooling, including Tenable Vulnerability Management, Tenable WAS, which is web app scanning, cloud security, and other tools. Cloud security is specifically built for vulnerability management, cloud security posture management, code scanning, container image scanning, managing multiple cloud environments. This is the very highest levels as I'm describing it, but you'll see in a second. And it's built for the unique challenges of cloud computing. And when we talk about that, we recognize that there are people who lift and shift, who take workloads from on-prem perhaps and sort of replicate that. We're really moving beyond that. You can do that with Tenable Cloud Security. You can use Nessus and other Tenable tools, but we're talking about a lot of the cloud native workflows and steps. So with that, I'm going to have Robert share his screen and start walking us through there. Of course, you know, the first step is going to be onboarding, but I'll let him really define these things as we go.
Fantastic. Yeah, let's go ahead and hop into things. So hopefully everybody can see here. We have our landing page for the Tenable Cloud Security Suite. There's a lot of data here that we won't get into yet. But, you know, sort of as I mentioned, kind of the primary use case that we typically run into and generally where I start is around cloud security posture management. What are the configuration of those cloud services? And are they being configured to best practice and secure standard? So we can take a look at my environment here. And I like to live dangerously. All this is live infrastructure. You can see here that we have fairly broad support across at least the major cloud service providers. Today, we do support Amazon, Azure, and Google Compute, as well as most of your standard Kubernetes platforms. So EKS, AKS, GKE, as well as some of the more self-hosted offerings like Rancher and even just vanilla Kubernetes. And really, you know, we take a fairly unified approach across all of these. We see all these platforms as essentially infrastructure platforms that we can query for inventory and configuration via APIs. And so that gives us a fairly unified picture across them. So as we're looking across our supported cloud service providers, take a similar approach to how we speak to them, you know, kind of the level of effort and the process to actually onboard and start getting some value on the platform. So for Amazon, we would be looking at a role ARN with typically just a read-only access policy. There's a few features that might require more permissions, but I'll get to those in a little bit. But similarly, on the Azure side, we would be using a service principal with typically the reader role. And similarly, on the Google side, we'll be using a service account with the viewer role. Fairly standard across those service providers. We run our own cloud scanners, so there's no engineering overhead as far as that goes. Scanning mechanism is going to be slightly different for Kubernetes, but we can tackle that as we get there.
And I think, you know, one of the keys here, you know, with these, if you've ever been into any of these cloud providers individually, they're kind of different. They're a lot of the same, but they name things differently. They refer to things slightly differently. Onboarding is slightly different. We standardize as much as we possibly can throughout this. And you'll see as Robert goes through the standardization of the various resources. So you don't have to be an expert in each one of the you know, particularly the nomenclature and the sort of the variabilities of those clouds.
Yeah, absolutely. And by no means would I call myself an expert either. So we're trying to do a lot of normalization and simplification of the platform to help you get direct access to the data that's most important to you. So with that, across the board, like I said, we're using these credentials to be able to speak to those cloud APIs on your behalf and ultimately just looking to pull down inventory and configuration. And so for a security use case, obviously we need something to evaluate those configurations against. And so we are using the Open Policy Agent as our policy enforcement engine. And so for instance, for Amazon, we have somewhere in the neighborhood of 600 policies that cover 70 to 80 different Amazon services. And then we curate those policies into about 30 different regulatory frameworks. So you can really tailor the security posture for your requirements within this environment. So here I was, I guess, previously giving a combination of a GDPR and PCI DSS demo, but we also support the various flavors of CIS and HIPAA and SOC 2, ISO 27001, any number of these. That remains fairly similar across all of our supported platforms. Obviously, different platforms offer different services. So for Amazon, for Azure, we have somewhere in the neighborhood of 450 policies across about 60 to 70 different services. Similarly with Google, as well as Kubernetes.
And by having those benchmarks built in and policies added to them, that means that you can get a real leg up, right, Robert? On, you know, you don't have to go, okay, I have to create, we have to adhere to CIS 1.4, what are all the moving parts? We've done that work for you, put them into these easily applied policies, regulations. GDPR, you know, there's a lot of folks, our customers and users in Europe, pretty strict and, you know, easy to miss something and expose yourself to a lot of expensive and costly repairs and lawsuits. And by encapsulating those, we've taken a lot of that effort away.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of these regulatory benchmarks have a lot of teeth. You mentioned GDPR, HIPAA has teeth. And so we're trying to do our best to automate a lot of that complexity, or at least let us take on that complexity into building and maintaining these various benchmarks that you can apply, and then also having the flexibility so you can customize them to your particular needs as well. So ultimately, we're trying to automate out a lot of that complexity as you're applying and trying to keep track with these regulations and audits and what have you.
So you've onboarded cloud accounts, and we talked a little bit about code, and there's a capability here also to onboard your Git repos.
Absolutely. Though I will caution you, and this is the first part where we'll tends to have a little bit of confusion, because we've also already talked about application security. So we do absolutely have integrations with most of your common version control providers. specifically around kind of the automation frameworks around how you actually build out these environments. So when I say automation, I'm talking about Terraform and CloudFormation and Helm charts, things along those lines, not so much the application code itself. But what this allows us to do is create that more complete picture around how you're actually building and maintaining these cloud workloads or containerized workloads. We'll get to here in a second. So in my case, I do use Terraform across all my cloud demos here. So I have a Git repository with my Terraform code that can now onboard as part of this project to say that as I'm looking at, you know, the state and security of my cloud runtime, I also want to compare that to the state and security of kind of what amounts to the source of truth around these kind of automation frameworks. So we'll see in a little bit where we'll have a much more complete picture of kind of the entire life cycle around how I'm building out this cloud environment.
Yeah, and I love the, we talk about code to cloud, but it's really, there's a whole bunch of different folks in here that can get involved earlier and without a lot of overhead, as you'll see in some of these, you know, when you're scanning repos or local code or local images or images that are in repositories. These are flows that developers are very used to and are very, you know, similar. They don't even have to know some of these, like the policies that Robert applied, to be able to take advantage of them in the code, which is powerful, because we all know people are you know, and I can say lazy, but they're not going to be experts in everything, but they also want to not break their workflow to do whether it's security or anything. And by making it very simple to do and familiar, they're not going to make an end run around it in your organization. And nor do they have to go back to school to, you know, become something that they're not.
Yeah, I mean, kind of ultimately the goal is we don't want to add a ton of friction to these processes, whether it's a DevOps process or what have you. And as you'll see as we go forward, a lot of this is centered around integrating with current processes and current workflows in a way that ideally, again, just doesn't introduce a ton of friction, so we can set up these tight feedback loops and really reduce our mean time to remediation.
Automation is king.
In a perfect world. So great. So we've talked about how we can talk to cloud APIs, how we can pull down inventory and configuration, how we compare those configurations against best practices, and at least started to take a look at how we can account for other pieces of the puzzle as we build out this overall kind of larger security posture. So here, I can run a cloud scan. It typically doesn't take that long, but I actually have my environments to configure to run daily. All these scans can be scheduled. So as I'm sitting here, literally drinking the last of my coffee, I have a nice new data set from my actually all my cloud service providers. So my Amazon kicked off at 11:55 last night. Google and Azure were earlier this morning. And so we have a nice new data set across all of my environments. And so we can come in through here and we can see sort of the various services. Like I said, for Amazon, we have 70 to 80 different services that we can account for. We can see some problem areas across those services. So it looks like I have some areas of concern across my security groups. We can drill down in there, see those instances again, see where our areas of concern are, and drill down into sometimes I'd say almost an unnecessary amount of detail, but the detail is there where you can see individual services, instances of those services, those service configurations, and probably kind of the primary data point here is how the configuration of those services sort of impact whatever regulatory requirements we may have defined for this environment. So here I have a security group with some wildly over-permissive ports, namely SSH being accessible to the public internet, which is a finding under pretty much every regulatory framework. A lot of great data here. And you're probably thinking to yourself that this is an eye chart. This is really getting into the weeds. And you're absolutely right. This sort of view is great for remediation and triage. But by and large, the organizations that we talk to want to be able to take a step up, a level up, and say, from a bird's eye view, I want to be able to see kind of what is my overall security posture in a way that might move the needle a little bit more. And so we absolutely do give you that ability here where we can say, whether it's for our entire Amazon estate, or, you know, I've been talking about Amazon, let's hop over to Azure. Say for my entire Azure estate, or it could be for a particular Azure subscription or resource group. We want to be able to see how we're doing against, well, let's do the latest CIS standard here. And so now we're able to see across the infrastructure that we want to focus on, how is it impacting our CIS posture? And we can get that same level of detail. In fact, I have a very similar configuration here where to be able to drill down, like I said, we have SSH accessible across the public internet, be able to take a look at that same level of detail, but now we're sort of visualizing it from a higher level view, a more compliance focused view, where we can then report on that and share that with the stakeholders that, well, in this environment might be concerned with your CIS posture, it's PCI DSS or GDPR or whatever regulatory standard you might be targeting for this environment. So this is kind of classic cloud security posture management. It's probably the most widely adopted of the feature sets that we see around cloud security, but it is kind of a foundational use case. And probably, like I said, the primary use case that as we're talking to customers that they're targeting. And I really want to start here because now we can start building that larger, that broader cloud and container security story, as you'll see here in a few minutes.
In misconfigurations, Robert, you know, we're talking about the cloud environment and, you know, it goes to the shared responsibility model that we know that the public cloud default settings are not that secure. All you have to do is spin up, some small instance based on that and scan it, and you'll, your eyes will pop out of your head. but the... you know, this is the configuration of that environment before we've even put anything in it. And as you know, things like the subnets, the roles and users, access, and of course you have then other resources like S3 buckets, encryption, you name it, before you even put anything in there. And I guess this in legacy thought, this is sort of when the operations guys used to hand you a server that they'd hardened, that they took 3 months to create for you. You haven't done anything yet. You have, that's sort of this piece of it, which is critical, and you are responsible. The cloud provider, makes sure no one can get into that data center and some other sort of low-level stuff, but you're responsible for all those capabilities and the security around them.
Yeah, the shared security model gets interesting where they'll say like, all right, this piece is a complete black box. You need to trust us to and assume that we're going to take care of the security here. But everything outside that black box is absolutely your responsibility. We take no ownership of any of this. We as in the cloud service provider. So being aware where those lines are, and then obviously having solutions to be able to address where your responsibility starts becomes critically important.
Yeah, and misconfigurations are different for everybody to an extent. Like if you are adhering to certain policies and benchmarks, something that doesn't comply is misconfigured. But you may be doing something different from me, and maybe I have, even within my workloads, I have a public facing web server for our app. Maybe I'm Walmart. Well, that's going to have ports 443 open, and it's going to have access to web server, and things like that, that are not misconfigured in that use case. So it's not we're throwing everything into the bucket. It's you're able to tune these things to meet your specific use case across that. I also wanted to say, you know, when Robert onboarded systems, you can onboard at the organizational level. So as you're adding other users under that organization, you're able to see that as well, which is a big part of the misconfiguration story and just visibility, right? Because as people are doing things in the cloud and spinning them up, you have some insight into that.
That's actually really important. Something that I probably should have touched on is, you know, typically and probably the most common use case that we see is you'll have a parent organization, and I believe all the cloud service providers support this, where you have a larger sort of corporate account, and then different teams spin up sub-accounts, subscriptions, and the terminology differs as they have different projects that they're trying to address. A lot of it is sort of billing and chargeback. And so being able to take into account new infrastructure as it gets spun up, or at least getting visibility as your cloud environment might be scaling out, and you might not have that level of oversight that you need. So having the ability to actually take into account of scale up like that becomes critically important, because otherwise, without that, you know, you have different teams basically building infrastructure with no oversight. And so being able to take, you know, a look at those parent accounts, those organizational accounts becomes a big part of the story as we get into the cloud security piece.
So we talked about misconfigurations, which is that environment, and, you know, we move beyond that or up the stack, you know, into the actual instances and things that you're deploying. And as Robert said, you know, he's using Terraform. A lot of folks do. And there's other technologies, of course, to do that stuff. And you're provisioning systems. And this is often even before the application itself. Sometimes they're dovetailed together, sometimes they're not. Sometimes you have a need to do them separately. Of course, you know, if you think about a CI/CD workflow, those are different things, but we can check that and we'll talk a little bit about that. So what's next now that we've gone this far, Robert?
Well, so, you know, before I move on, I did at least want to touch on, and basically it's something I do fairly often, is I could have given the same demo around cloud security for Kubernetes. And like I said, we address Kubernetes in much the same way. We have the same policy sets. We have the same really sort of high level overview about how we address Kubernetes, up to and including a lot of those regulatory benchmarks that we can apply to your Kubernetes estate. And so as I refer back to sort of, this is my version of the slide we were looking at earlier, that sort of encompasses this middle layer around cloud security posture management and Kubernetes security posture management. I think the next piece of the puzzle is sort of, what are the workloads that we're actually hosting on this cloud or containerized infrastructure? And like I said, Tenable's been doing vulnerability management now for quite a while, but how can we shift that kind of core competency around vulnerability management into these newer and sometimes dramatically different platforms? And there's two sides of the story. I'll start on the cloud side, because that tends to be the most popular, where, you know, we really put a lot of work into thinking about how organizations can really sort of refactor their vulnerability management program in a way that is much more cloud native. And so we do still have quite a few customers that will embed their, like a Nessus agent into their AMIs and base images. I still have customers that will deploy network scanners to their various VPCs and subnets. But those have their own architectural challenges. And so we wanted to really at least try to start streamlining a lot of those processes. And so with that, late last year, we introduced a capability called agentless assessment. Agentless assessment today is available for both Amazon and Azure. And we're hoping to have Google support maybe later this year, but it's essentially on the roadmap. And basically what's happening is every time I run a cloud security scan within these environments, I'm automatically getting a vulnerability assessment. Well, let's actually get into the data and then we'll get into sort of how we're getting here and what some of those guardrails are. But here, if you've ever run a vulnerability management program, a lot of this data should be fairly familiar to you. So I chose my Azure environment since I spent most of my time earlier on Amazon, where we have, I have a few Ubuntu instances that are just deliberately unpatched, and we're seeing the sort of data you would expect from a vulnerability management program. We've enumerated all of my CVEs, their associated CVSS scores, and we even have VPR scores, which if you're not familiar with some of the core kind of Tenable vulnerability management offerings, is essentially what our security and research team has determined as the real world impact of these CVEs. You know, have we seen these CVEs being exploited currently in the wild? Is there any automation around those exploits? Is it just a part of Metasploit? So any 16-year-old can then hack your infrastructure, giving you sort of that primary level of prioritization as you're looking at these CVEs. And for those of you who are familiar with the Tenable Vulnerability Management Platform, all this data, in fact, everything I've shown you here so far, does make it into that sort of mainline, the universal workspace, as we call it. So you can start associating your cloud misconfigurations, cloud vulnerabilities with maybe some of your more traditional vulnerability scans through Tenable.io or Nessus or what have you here. Go ahead.
Before you left that screen, I wanted to draw our viewers' attention to the scan origin column here over to the right, which says agentless assessment, container security, image scanning. This is giving you that source, and Robert in these examples is, you know, pulling in a lot of different stuff from a bunch of what we would call sensors and amalgamating it into a single view here under Tenable Vulnerability Management. You know, I also wanted to touch on what you were talking about with the agentless assessment, where, and it's like difference from Nessus agents and network scan. Unlike those, where if, particularly if you're using an agent, you have to have an instance that can handle it and it's big enough and you have permission to do that. It's not gonna interfere with something else running on that. That's really your critical workload. And for a network scanner, which require credentials, agentless assessment doesn't require that. And instead of scanning the actual running instance, it's running its scan on a snapshot, which means that your instance can be of any size. And ultimately, it doesn't have to be running. It has to still exist, but it doesn't have any impact on that workload as well. Did I get that
exactly?
Right?
And yeah, so that kind of gets to the core of how we're doing this. And some of the guardrails around, you know, how it works is we are using snapshots. Snapshots give us a static file system that we can query over the same cloud APIs that we're using for security assessments. And so this is where we might be asking for some additional permissions. We need access to the storage APIs, essentially. But as long as we have an existing snapshot with a supported operating system, which is the other large guardrail around this today, it is kind of Linux only. So Ubuntu, Red Hat, Oracle, SUSE, or Amazon, and some flavors of CentOS, we can just use those native APIs to query those for our security assessment. So great. So that is agentless assessment. And like John said, it's just another sensor. You can think about it the same way that you would any vulnerability management assessment. We're just accomplishing that in a much more cloud native fashion, and you're able to sort of utilize that and some of the native vulnerability management tooling that has always been a part of Tenable. Like automated reporting and dashboarding and filtering and what have you. For those of you who are sharp-eyed, and John also mentioned this, is you also seen here, some of these scan origins are for containers. And so that gets to the next part of this conversation is, you know, yes, cloud compute instances are a little bit different than your normal sort of on-premise VMs and servers, but containers are vastly different. You're not installing agents on the container, or I please ask you not to install agents on the container, kind of an anti-pattern. Same thing for exposing SSH to do sort of credentialed scans. So how do you run a vulnerability management program in for your containerized infrastructure? And so it's actually something we've had within the platform for quite a while, but we've gone through a fairly major refactor of the capabilities into what we call our container security offering. And so we have, I'll get into sort of the nuts and bolts of this in a moment, but essentially we're treating the containers in the same way that we were treating your compute instances with agentless assessment. We're using our scanning mechanisms to look at the underlying file system, using that to build out sort of a simplified software bill of materials that we can then run through. It's the same vulnerability and plugin database that we use for the rest of our vulnerability assessments, but now we're able to apply those specifically to the container images themselves. I will caution you, because this is where we get into interesting gray areas. Containers and Kubernetes are fairly unique beasts. And so we are not scanning these containers in runtime as they're running. So that's going to be a fairly large difference than how you might imagine a vulnerability management platform within the cloud or for your traditional infrastructure, mostly because going back to that kind of shared security model, Amazon or most container platforms in general do not expose those layers for assessment. So how are we assessing these container images for vulnerabilities? Well, there's two major workflows that we are supporting today. Probably the most common and where most of our customers will start is actually scanning their container registry. So whether you're using something like the Elastic Container Registry within Amazon, Docker Hub, Artifactory, JFrog, what have you, you can scan with some credentials. You can feed in an allow list, a deny list, or a time gate. So essentially you can say, hey, Elastic Container Registry, I want to scan every image that's been uploaded in the past 30 days. And so we'll just parse through those images and you'll see the results here. In fact, I haven't shown you those results. Let's make that a little bit more interesting and actually show you some of those results.
And there's a key difference here, and you hit it just a moment ago, Robert, that it's not practical to scan running containers. First of all, unlike the instances, you may have thousands or millions of those. And the reality is you shouldn't need to do that, because scanning the image from which each one of those containers is created is the heart of the scan. In other words, yes, you want to know if something drifted or something's changed, but if that happens, you're not going to make changes to those containers. You're changing the image, you're updating the image. The image is the goal here.
Yeah, there's this concept in containerized infrastructure called immutability. You're starting to see that even on some of the more traditional cloud pieces, but the whole idea of your change management is a redeploy. It takes typically, you know, seconds at the most to redeploy new containers. So there's typically an automated workflow around making changes and just redeploying out a new workload. And so that's why it becomes so effective and kind of a best practice to capture issues within the containers before they ever get deployed. So almost kind of like shift left for containers, I guess I'd say.
Right. Shifting left within shifting left.
Exactly. In fact, that's the other major workflow that we do support. So I talked about, you know, scanning container registries so you can see those containerized artifacts before you deploy them. Well, kind of the ultimate goal is to actually embed these scans into these container build pipelines. So typically engineering teams will have some sort of automated process that combines a Docker file or description of a container with their application code, and then stages that and uploads it to your container registry. Well, we can also scan local containers as part of that pipeline. So you can actually introduce some additional security assurance, again, even before, much less deploying them, before they even get uploaded to your container registry, just as another layer of security there.
Yeah, there's 2 points I wanted to tease out there. One is that this is a CLI-based process, which enables you, yes, I can do it at my workstation, but I can very readily plug them into the workflow that Robert was talking about, meaning that I can trigger this scan. And the other piece is that it's linked back to the dashboard and the security policies that I'm running through a configuration file. So someone running this either in a CI/CD pipeline or on their workstation doesn't have to go, oh, what policies do I need to apply? They're already built into the configuration based on the project that you're scanning.
Exactly.
And here is the CLI. And in this case, Robert is about to scan using container security an image. This could also be a registry. And he's got some other information in here.
Yep. So this is where you would scan a local container image. It'll actually give you immediate feedback. So it's great for part of an automated test pipeline versus scanning. This is literally my container registry. I'm obfuscating out some of the API calls here, but taking a very simplified approach, a very automatable approach to how we're looking at container security.
Yeah, and you know, meaning that someone who's developing something can run this, someone who's later pushed it, we can scan the code. If that code gets pushed, we can then scan the build and the output of that. And it's all a unified policy. It's not applying different things at different levels. It's a single policy framework that's basically been vetted not only by Tenable, but by your security team.
Yep. And sort of in the interest of time, I wanted to build off of that for a couple minutes, because that kind of gets into a lot of our point of view as we're looking at container security, obviously, but also cloud security, is automating a lot of these processes so that they just become part of your overall management of your cloud and containerized environments. So I mentioned earlier, you know, we've been talking about embedding security scans into your container build process. I also mentioned earlier that I'm using Terraform to build out a lot of my cloud environments, and we can apply those same sort of workflows and policies. So, you know, in the same way that we're capturing vulnerabilities at the container side at build time, now I can address and capture misconfigurations at the cloud service layer through those kind of infrastructure or automation native testing pipelines. So this is just an example of what I use within my Terraform environment in Amazon, where anytime I make a change to my Terraform code, it's going to pull off those changes. It's going to apply the same 600 some odd policies or whatever policy framework that I've defined for that environment. But now we're actually able to apply this. In this case, it's for Terraform, but it could be ARM templates for your Kubernetes, and ARM templates for Azure, or Helm charts for your Kubernetes environments. There's a number of different automation platforms that we support, but I at least wanted to touch on that because it becomes such a powerful model for cloud and container security in general to be able to capture these sort of issues before they ever get deployed.
And we added with container security, you can still create your own policies. For example, I noticed that you have, it's running on Ubuntu latest. You know, like, you could set up a rule if you don't want to ever use a container image that is the latest, but has, you want one that's versioned, you can set up and create those custom policies as well, you know, which is very granular on things related to that image building process and sources. So a lot of flexibility in the no code, and I'd like to say no code because it's really an and or Boolean kind of thing where you say, hey, make this particular value equal this, and
So we use the Open Policy Agent as sort of the engine behind all of this. It's an open platform. Obviously, we curate and take along a lot of that complexity as Tenable, but we're also giving you, like John was saying, the ability to customize In a way that doesn't require a lot of complexity. So a lot of low code, you know, here we'll take a look at an Azure Windows function. And it's just a matter of finding the parameters that fit your particular use case, building tests, and make it fairly trivial to customize to your specific needs.
A lot of capability in there. One of the things that you talked about, and I thought maybe you could show this too, Robert, was, you know, some of these workflows. We have, you know, Jira ticket integration, good Git pull requests and integration. We also have some chat ops and tie-ins to some other native processes. And what that means is, if you're familiar with Tenable, we don't just give you, hey, here's the problem, we give you the remediation information. And these integrations include that remediation information. Like if you're doing a PR, you've discovered a problem, it's critical, you want it to be fixed. You don't have to copy what it is, whatever it happens to be. It's going to take the specific finding from Tenable Cloud Security here. It's going to quote the information, including the remediation, and send that along in the PR and or the ticket that you created. Again, goes back to what I said very early on, that, you know, we want to make these as frictionless, and that's Robert's word, as possible in that flow. So people are doing familiar things. They're not guessing. They don't have to hunt around and track somebody down to get to the next step.
Yeah, it kind of, it comes down to setting up feedback loops between, you know, typically security groups aren't the ones that are responsible for remediation here. So we want to be able to communicate back to those engineers responsible and say, hey, we found issues and, you know, here's some recommendations on how we can fix this. And so with that, we offer a few different remediation workflows. Like John was mentioning, we do support ticketing systems with the Jira integration, so kind of ticket-based remediation there. We do also support more chat ops with Slack and Microsoft Teams, so you can have kind of a channel that engineers can be subscribed to with kind of a running tally of discovered misconfigurations and vulnerabilities. And then obviously sort of table stakes things like sending out email alerts and things along those lines. What I like, you know, one of the most interesting workflows, I guess I would say, though it's a fairly targeted use case, is if you are using Terraform within your cloud environments, we can actually integrate, if you recall earlier, where I was integrating in with GitHub, well, we can actually create pull requests directly against Terraform repositories. So if you recall earlier, I was talking about a vulnerability where I was having SSH overexposed here. Well, this is where Tenable Cloud Security has actually created a pull request against my Terraform repository, giving the engineers some sort of context around why this might be an issue. But again, at least for Terraform, we're actually able to call out individual lines of code to say, hey, maybe we shouldn't be exposing these service ports out to the global internet. Here's a secure subnet or a jump box that might be a more secure option here. So again, this is fairly specific to Terraform, but it gives you an idea of at least what I consider probably the most elegant feedback loop between security and DevOps groups.
And we even have the capability to provide the suggested solution for some of these things, like in changing this CIDR, you know, someone might be like, I don't know what CIDR to use, like what, you know, so being, again, able to communicate that by preceding some of those values is a critical piece here as well. And, you know, because there's a lot of moving parts, we try to really understand, because I think we do a good job of this, Robert, in understanding the job of each person in this stage and, you know, speeding the process and allowing the limited human resources to focus on what's most critical. And in the last couple minutes, I thought we could tease some of the, you know, the Lumen stuff,
Absolutely.
Which is, you know, we're at, people are on the ground, practitioners doing the work every day. There are people who are your bosses and their bosses who want to know what are the things that are higher up. What's our position compared with other people in our industry or whatever that happens to be. Where are we? How are we doing over time?
Yeah, absolutely. And so, you know, like I said, I like to refer back to the slide you see I've done a few times, because, you know, you can see how this is kind of the template for how Tenable looks at these cloud and containerized workloads. And there are a lot of moving pieces, and I've shown you a lot of different reports and a lot of different dashboards. But what I haven't shown you yet is basically, what does this look like as a report? You know, I want to be able to see that I'm hosting this application and I've scanned it for vulnerabilities and it's running on these EC2 instances. I want to see their security posture and it's running these cloud services. And the same idea, I want to be able to get a full bird's eye view of this workload in a report, in so I can share that to my key stakeholders without having to do all these different reports to different people, different responsibilities. And so with that, like John was saying, we have a fairly new offering called Lumen Exposure View. And the kind of core thrust to this is Tenable has a broad portfolio where, as we even just seen in what we've looked at today, we're pulling in a ton of different security data from different security domains, and we want to be able to collect it into a single report that moves that needle. And so here I have a conveniently named scorecard called Full Exposure Risk, and this is exactly what that is. It is not just the cloud security data that I collected from cloud security. It's also the vulnerability data that I've collected through agentless assessment. It's also, I've run some web application scans in this environment as well. And so this is giving us idea of the full exposure of this particular workload and all the different sort of data points that feed into this. And so here I have a very simple sort of ABCDF, what is the overall security posture here? How is that security posture compared to other peers in my industry? I'm guessing that's for software vendors here. As we go down, we can identify or define SLAs and see how we're performing against them. There's all these data points sort of from a high level around what is the health and security of this entire workload. But sort of my favorite piece of this, and I'm going to hop over to my Azure environment to illustrate this, is like John was saying, like, how has my security posture evolved over time here? And so we can see a few months ago, I had some sort of event in my Azure environment. My security posture took a turn for the worse. This is like golf, a lower score is better. And obviously we're giving you the data points that feed into these sort of areas of concern. So I can see as this happens, my own average vulnerabilities tripled, my asset criticality ratings went up, number of clean assets went down. We'll come to find out that that was the day that I turned on agentless assessment in my Azure environment. So of course I'm spinning up new infrastructure and that infrastructure is insecure. So I'm generating more results for that environment, which is not going to have a positive impact on my overall security posture, but kind of gives you a view into, you know, how we're able to address and offer more context for these cloud environments and hopefully allow your teams and your management to make the best decisions possible.
We have a previous episode on particularly integrating Tenable Cloud Security and Tenable Web App Scanning and seeing some of these Lumen exposure views, not only by compute, but we've added tags, and there's a nice discussion in that session about tagging, but that enables you to see your overall security, the application and compute, you know, separately, to see like, oh, my environment's fine, but my application is not fine, right? So rather than just going, oh, there's a problem, we're able to really drill down into that. And as Robert's just shown, see the improvement or opposite of improvement, over time, which is critically important. I see we're at the top of the hour. Gosh, we could go on all day, Robert. Please be sure to check out some of the previous coffee breaks where we cover elements of this. The agentless assessment for Azure, I wrote a blog that has some embedded videos in it as well. That's available at tenable.com/blogs. And a number of great resources. I want to thank Robert for taking the time today to go through a lot of stuff here, and hopefully you, the viewers, have seen a takeaway of some of the strengths here as well. I have to say too that we're looking forward to more shows, but we're going on a short hiatus. It is summertime, and we will return in September. But until then, thanks very much for joining us. Have a great week.
Appreciate it.